Howdy, folks. Dr. Will Wong here, and welcome to tonight's edition of the Essentials of Life and Wellness. The subject of C60, carbon 60, came up in a Patrick Timpone show that I did a few weeks ago, and a few of you, especially of my email group, came together, doctors, engineers, software engineers, electronics experts, and to a man, they all agreed, this is bad stuff. Now, the reason for taking C60 is because it supposedly energizes all the cells of the body, and most especially, the people who push C60 really push this one point. It spiritualizes the body. It somehow makes the connection between the body and the soul and the etheric or the mystical stuff much better so that you can better connect with the spiritual world and blah, 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 blah. Okay. I'm a priest. I've been practicing spirituality since I was 12. Was doing Zazen Chin at 12. Been dead twice. I've attained mystical union. I've done all sorts of spiritual stuff. Didn't have to eat anything to do it. So what's really going on with the C60 stuff? I will refer you first to a YouTube video titled Wi-Fi for Your Mind, C60, the Pharmakia Panacea. Again, the title is Wi-Fi for Your Mind, C60, the Pharmakia Panacea. Then, as one of the engineers in our group pointed out, Cliff High, whom I greatly admire, he is the webmaster of halfpasthuman.com. He's created web bots. He's done all sorts of really interesting stuff. He was really pushing the C60 and really advocating it a few months ago, and then come to find out that all of a sudden, he developed a huge tumor and has cancer. And when he was first advocating the C60, he looked great. And now he looks not so great. Could the C60 have been the cause of his sudden development of cancer? Good question. And for this, I will send you to go find a paper. Now get a pencil and paper now, because this is a long title. Ready? It is from academicoup.com. academicoup.com. And the title of the paper is A Large-Scale Association Study for Nanoparticle 60 Uncovers Mechanisms of Nanotoxicity Disrupting the Native Conformations of DNA RNA. And again, I'll read it to you. A Large-Scale Association Study for Nanoparticle 60 Uncovers Mechanisms of Nanotoxicity Disrupting the Native Conformations of DNA RNA. In other words, what the study found, the C60 hijacks your DNA and tears it apart. It is nanotoxic. In other words, this little thing is toxic to your cells at a really tiny level, like the DNA level. The next paper from the Journal of Biophysics, December of 2005, titled C60 Binds to and Deforms Nucleotides. C60 binds to and deforms nucleotides. Okay, so we know that this stuff goes into the body and disrupts DNA. The doctors have told us that the C60 goes in and has no way to get out. It can't be metabolized. It can't be broken down. It isn't gotten rid of by the liver. It isn't gotten rid of through the urine. It isn't gotten rid of at all. It stays inside of you. What does it do? Well, aside from disrupting DNA, a couple of our electrical engineers had the idea that since this stuff vibrates in electrical fields, especially electrical fields of particular frequency, like the frequency that's about to be introduced everywhere through G5, they may be looking at something that actually disrupts brain and body function. What? a particle that goes inside of you and begins to vibrate and starts shaking and starts doing all sorts of weird-ass stuff when exposed to G5 electrical fields? Interesting. Why would anyone want you to eat that stuff? Why would anyone in their right mind want you to put this stuff inside your body that can't get out? And what exactly is it supposed to do when it goes in and starts vibrating to the electrical fields of the cell phone towers, the G5 towers? Maybe it'll actually vibrate to the G4 and G3 towers. Maybe this is what these guys are getting at when they say that it increases your spirituality, your connectiveness. Maybe it turns you into a Wi-Fi conductor so that you're picking up all the stuff that they want to transmit to you. Maybe it isn't God talking to you when you eat the C60. Maybe it's someone much lower, someone in a control room with electronic gadgets pumping suggestions into your brain. And just maybe, if you've seen the first Kingsman movie, when someone flips a switch, just like all those folks who had all those special phones in the Kingsman movie, maybe something really, really, really bad will happen when they flip the switch to all the folks who have the C60 inside of them. Regardless of what the conspiracy theory may be, the science says it's bad for your DNA. And just because it happens to be sold as a nutritional supplement or by nutritional supplement people doesn't mean it's good for you. Remember that the folks in the nutritional supplement industry are as bad a lot as anybody in the pharmaceutical industry. As a matter of fact, there's an awful hell of a lot of crossover as Monsanto, which is now Bayer, bought a good many of the really big nutritional companies way back in the 1990s and the early 2000s. Now, on a completely different subject, those of you listening to the show long enough know that I have railed against the use of the ADHD drugs in children. It will burn out their brains. Any kid on amphetamines who's been on amphetamines since grade school and then through high school cannot be expected to produce well in college. They're going to be wearing pajamas. They're going to be living in their parents' basements. They're going to be non-productive members of society, playing video games, staring at the walls, and drooling. And now Harvard Med, of all people, has come out with a study showing that the drugs used to treat ADD and ADHD produce psychosis. Well, no shit! They're amphetamines, for God's sakes. Anyone who lived through the 60s and 70s remembers all the amphetamine junkies, all the upper junkies, roaming around the streets, and they were all freaking nuts. But the ADHD drugs have now been proven to cause hallucinations, delusional disorder, schizophrenia, spectrum disorder, major depressive disorder, bipolar disorder. And I will quote from one of the doctors who did the study. There is not a lot of research comparing the safety profiles of amphetamines and methamphetamines, despite increasing use of these medications. Doctors have noted that patients without previous psychiatric history coming up with psychosis following stimulant use. One out of every 486 patients taking amphetamines later required treatment for psychosis. Now, this study covers youth being defined as whatever to 25 years old, grade schoolers to 25, who've been recently diagnosed with ADHD and started taking the medications, and not those who'd been previously treated with the medication. So, this has been happening in the kids lately because they haven't kept track of what was burning out kids' brains before. Okay. Is there any doubt that the methamphetamine addictions that are happening in the United States, the methamphetamine rush, the methamphetamine drug problem, is related to kids having been on ADD and ADHD drugs, whose brains now still want those drugs and can't get them legally because they're too old now and they don't have the diagnosis of ADD and ADHD. So where do they go? They go get the methamphetamines. A tweaker is a tweaker. and whether he was turned into amphetamine junkie by the doctors giving him ADHD drugs for a condition that absolutely frickin' does not exist. The psychiatrist who invented the diagnosis admitted on his deathbed that the diagnosis was phony and created to sell drugs. Guess he waited till he was dying so they wouldn't kill him for saying it. But all the MDs are doing are creating future methamphetamine junkies. Because once the brain gets used to having that stuff floating around, it really likes it. Just like the heroin junkies. So whether it's an upper or a downer, we're seeing the 1960s and 70s play out all over again, only this time it's partially legal. But think of it. It's great for the medical industry. They get to sell drugs legally. Then they get to sell more drugs when the kids become psychotic. The hospital systems stay in business. The psychiatric hospitals stay in business. It's flourishing. Think of the millions. Millions and billions. The ADHD drugs are creating in business to keep Big Pharma in cash. Okay, now here's a really, really, really weird one. Folks are getting, now, are you ready for this? Flesh-eating infections in their genitals, from taking type 2 diabetic medications called sodium glucose transponder inhibitors. In other words, the drugs Invokana and Forexgia. Flesh-eating bacteria, eating away your crotch, eating away your wally wally, your testicles, your vaginal lips, and your clitoris? That's nuts! So far, the FDA has identified 55 patients who received those drugs between March of 2013 and January of 2019. They ranged in age from 22 to 87 years. 1.7 million people received this prescription, roughly. Now, the patients all had damaged tissue that had to be surgically removed. They went fecal diversion surgery. In other words, they had to reposition. They had to move their anuses over and make them poop out of somewhere else because their pooper didn't exist anymore. It got eaten away by the flesh-eating bacteria. 2 required amputations, and 3 patients died. I'm sorry. You know, metformin is one of the safest drugs in the world. Metformin is one of the anti-aging drugs that helps us slow aging. Yes, metformin has its problems, but it won't eat away your crotch and your genitalia, folks. Now, this new class of diabetic medication also produces kidney infections, blood infections, diabetic ketoacidosis, and as we've already mentioned, risk of amputations from flesh-eating bacteria. Any of those things worth the danger of taking this medication? Okay, let's bash on drugs some more. There is evidence to show that Ambien, one of the most favorite sleep medications, is having people commit suicide. Other weird behavior, according to the FDA, Ambien causes abnormal thinking and behavioral changes. Ambien gives rise to bizarre behaviors, hallucinations, agitation, especially when mixed with other sedatives like alcohol. There is anecdotal evidence, and I'm continuing, that Ambien has people do really weird stuff. And I will quote, like a sleepy bride trying to build a bouquet holster, people building cabinets, peeing on their computers, and becoming racist suddenly. People having more severe hallucinations, like sleepwalking, operating heavy machinery, driving and not remembering. And now it seems it's all complicated by the fact that the newer studies show that painkillers don't work in folks who are sleep deprived. So imagine what happens when you get the Ambien plus an opiate painkiller. What the heck happens to your brain then? What do you do then? Who do you blame it on? All this polypharmacy, all this massive taking of many and varied medications mixed all together. One doc who writes you a prescription for this, another doc who writes you a prescription for that, Some other doctor writes you two prescriptions for contrary medications, and I've seen that happen. What happens when all that crap gets mixed up inside of the test tube called you? What happens to you, to your cells, to your body, especially to your brain, when all that stuff starts kicking in and kicking your ass? And let's try to get to some of your questions. And the first one reads, "Good day, Dr. Wong. After the age of 40, how does the following affect women? Estrogen, testosterone, and progesterone. What should be increased? What should be decreased? Thank you and God bless." And my answer is howdy. 40 for most gals is premenopause. In that phase of hormonal life, progesterone levels are dramatically lowered. You're likely not going to get pregnant and you're easing out of ovulation, so the progesterone is not needed. Testosterone is mostly non-existent. You're not having babies, so you don't need the libido, so the testosterone is out. The dopamine levels, the neurotransmitter of desire and lust, are dropping by 1 to 10% a year by age 40. Estrogen then is the only hormone you'll make consistently, and the reason why, even though you may or may not be making less estrogen, premenopausal gals are all estrogen dominant. As we know from the 50 to 60 years of clinical experience with birth control pills and women's estrogen replacement, estrogen dominance causes inflammation, which leads to fibrosis and the formation of excessive fibrin and fibrinogen in the blood, which may lead to heart attacks and strokes. Also, 97% of all cancers are sparked into life and driven in their growth by estrogen. Progesterone should be increased, as it takes 200 to 300 units of measure of progesterone to balance and control 1 unit of estradiol or estrone. This also improves mood and maintains brain size. Testosterone is needed to be increased to the level had in the late teens and early 20s because it maintains muscle mass, which in turn increases bone density. Medical doctors who would never study exercise physiology never learned that. Neither did the egghead scientists who try to develop anti-osteoporosis medications ever learn that from exercise physiology. Trying to maintain bone density without increasing the muscle mass needed to feed bone development is physiologically stupid and a violation of the true understanding of Wolf's Law, which properly states that mineralization is laid into bones along axial lines of stress. The typical medical understanding of Wolf's Law is that mineralization is put into bones upon weight bearing, not the same definition. If that definition were true, the simple act of just standing up and walking around would increase your bone density, but it doesn't. The true definition of Wolf's Law means that you have to push, pull, compress bones for them to get mineralized, and that you have to train the muscles above them. While the osteoporosis drugs, when they work, which they often don't, only increase bone density 2 to 3% when they do work, a good strength training program increases bone density in seniors 11 to 15%. If it does that for all seniors, then it will do it as well or better for pre-seniors if the work is heavy enough to cause the desired adaptation. That also means that the way women train, generally with light weights and many reps, is worthless to building bone. As to the supplements that would be of use for premenopausal gals, Karuna Pure Progesterone Cream, apply as per insert directions. Andean Essence Max, 2 capsules, 2 to 3 times a day. Enkindle, 2 capsules, 3 times a day. And Synest, 2 capsules before bed. Hope this covers your question. Be well and God bless. Dr. Wong. And the next question reads, "Dear Dr. Wong, I have recently been introduced to your radio program and have been catching up on your older programs. Additionally, your information has led me to change and improve my eating habits, supplement intake, and exercise. Better late than never. I have felt great, maybe not coincidentally. Recently, I purchased Guyton's Physiology, the 12th edition, and was troubled at the selection called Abnormalities of Male Sexual Function, where it says prostate cancer can usually be inhibited by administration of estrogens. This statement contradicts both your message and that of Soy Online Service. I hope you can appreciate my confusion. Given a series of elevated PSA counts over the years, with negative biopsy results. And my answer is howdy. That's all based on one 1947 study that was far from conclusive and never repeated or repeatable. Start with the first link and continue on to the rest. And I sent him on to read these particular articles and these particular studies. The first one is the testosterone way to a healthy heart, liver, circulation, fertility, and mood. The testosterone way to a healthy heart, liver, circulation, fertility, and mood at my website, totalityofbeing.com. The next article is Busting the Myth of Testosterone Therapy. Busting the Myth of Testosterone Therapy, and that's on foreverhealth.com. Next, the study titled Testosterone Therapy in Men with Hypogonadism Prevents Progression from Prediabetes to Type 2 Diabetes. Testosterone Therapy in Men with Hypogonadism Prevents the Progression from Prediabetes to Type 2 Diabetes. Next, from ScienceDirect.com comes a study, Low Free Testosterone is an Independent Risk Factor for High-Grade Prostate Cancer. I will repeat that because this one's really important to the question. Low free testosterone is an independent risk factor for high-grade prostate cancer. Another study from the same place, testosterone replacement therapy prevents disease progression in men undergoing radical prostatectomy. Testosterone replacement therapy prevents disease progression in men undergoing radical prostatectomy. Now, think about this. These men had their prostate removed because they had cancer. They are now given testosterone therapy, and the cancer goes away. This was shown to happen by the University of Chicago Med School, where they injected prostate cancer patients with testosterone directly into the tumor, and the tumor shrank. A testosterone-dominant prostate cancer patient does not exist. A testosterone-dominant swollen prostate patient does not exist. Estrogen-dominant prostate cancer patients all exist. Estrogen-dominant prostate swelling patients all exist. It's the estrogen that converts into dihydrotestosterone, which both of them, both the estrogen and the DHT, go to swell the prostate. But it's not testosterone that swells the prostate. And one more study from PubMed. Current opinion on the role of testosterone in the development of prostate cancer, a dynamic model. Current opinion on the role of testosterone in the development of prostate cancer, a dynamic model. And I continue my answer to this gentleman. Lastly, even the AMA now admits that PSA readings are meaningless and have zero connection with cancer. Hope this all helps. Be well and God bless, Dr. Wong. And on that note, I wish you all God's blessings. Be well, and I'll chat with you again next time.
Thank you for joining Dr. Wong this evening for the Essentials of Life and Wellness. If you have any questions about this show, or if you want to ask Dr. Wong any health-related questions, you may email those questions to him directly at askdrwong@drwongsessentials.com. The products Dr. Wong recommends can be found online at drwongsessentials.com, or you can speak with a customer service representative at 866-268-3216. Dr. Wong also has an extensive natural health website written in Dr. Wong's unique and easy-to-understand style that discusses remedies for some of today's most debilitating and chronic conditions. Those are at drwong.us. Dr. Wong's lecture and podcast from 2007 through 2016 can be heard at drwongradio.com. his podcasts since 2016, and his lecture, Fighting the Things Most Likely to Kill Us, can be found on YouTube by searching for Dr. William Wong's Essentials of Life and Wellness. Until next time, we hope you have a safe and healthy week. Be well and God bless.